Welcome to this seminar series on understanding the fundamentals of linear models. Now, I've already done this on the whiteboard. I'll link that right up here, or it'll be in the description down below. But as you can see here on the screen, we're going to discuss simple linear regression, one-way analysis of variance, one-way analysis of covariance, and binary logistic regression. Now, instead of explaining all these things on the whiteboard, I'm going to use a computer language, as you can see here. I'm using a Jupyter notebook inside of Visual Studio Code, and the kernel that I'm running is a Python kernel. So I'm going to assume that you understand a little bit of Python, and even if you don't, you're going to pick up some code here, but it's more about understanding what happens inside of these models, how we use them, what the results mean, so that you can interpret at least your own models or those that you see in the literature. So in this first video then, we're going to discuss simple linear regression. And right off the bat, remember, the simple refers to that we're only going to have one independent variable. So as we can see here in equation one, we're going to have an independent variable, and from that, we're going to try and estimate a value for a dependent variable. That is what modeling, or at least the fundamentals of modeling, is all about. And we use models in two main ways. The first one is to understand this relationship between your independent variable or variables and your dependent variable. We can express all sorts of values to understand that relationship. We can also just build a model that will predict or estimate a value of that dependent variable. So given any input values for our independent variable or variables, we can calculate an estimated dependent variable. And we would use that, for instance, in machine learning, or in cases where, you know, getting the value, actually going out and getting the value of the dependent variable might be very expensive, in monetary terms, expensive in time that it takes, or human resources. And if we have a set of data available to us, we build this model so that in future we only need these easier to collect independent variables so that we can calculate a value for the dependent variable. Now, this table we're going to see all the time. Those are the, as I said, the four fundamental types of linear models that I want to talk to you about. And we see what type, what data type the independent variable must take versus what the dependent variable must take. So if we talk about simple linear regression, we're going to have some interval type. That means a numerical variable for our independent variable, simple, meaning we'll only have one. And for our dependent variable, we also have an interval scale variable or a numerical variable. And that means if you have a data set and you have all your observations, there'll be pairs of values, one value for the independent variable and one value for the dependent variable. So here's our first bit of Python. We are going to import some packages. Remember, Python is a base language. We're using version 3.9.10, as you can see right here at the top. And we extend the capabilities of that language by importing some packages, and those packages are written by people all over the world, and that is the beauty of open source software, that there's so many people who contribute to this. And of course, we've always got to state that these people have to be supported as much as possible, either in academia or in other financial terms, because their contribution to our scientific world is just absolutely enormous. So we're going to import the pandas package, and that helps us with creating a data frame that's going to store all our data. We're going to import NumPy, that's the numerical package NumPy. We're going to import the stats module from the SciPy, or Scientific Python module. And then we're also going to import the PATSY package, and that's going to help us create design matrices, and you'll see what that is all about. And I'm just going to click on run, and that's going to execute that cell, importing for me all those packages. What you'll notice here, if you're familiar with Python, I'm not using namespace abbreviation. So we would usually say import pandas as PD so that I can use that abbreviation. But for here, we're going to go for the full package name. Then for all my plotting needs, I'm going to import the plotly package, and specifically the express module and the graph objects module, and then also the IO module, so that I can say io.templates.default, and I'm going to set that to plotly underscore dark, because I'm using a dark theme here so that my plots look nice on this dark theme. And then the heavy lifting for our models are going to be created using the statsmodels package. And we're going to just import two functions. So from the formula.api module, in stats models, I'm going to import the OLS function. And then from the stats.anova module, I'm going to import the ANOVA underscore LM function. Those are the two functions from stats models that we're going to use in the majority of our work when it comes to linear models in the seminar series. So what is a simple linear regression all about? Well, it's about a research question. I have a research question and I want to state that very clearly with respect to the variables that I do have. So in this case of simple linear regression, I'm building this question. I'm going to have some intercept plus a slope times my independent variable, and that'll give me an estimated dependent variable value. What does this mean in words? Well, it's asking, can I use my independent variable as a predictor for my dependent variable? In other words, stating this in terms of hypothesis testing, as far as a null hypothesis is concerned, I'm going to state that my independent variable is not a predictor of my dependent variable. And my alternative hypothesis would be that my independent variable value is a predictor of my dependent variable value. And when we get to writing this in symbolic notation, I'll show you the symbols that we could use in our null and alternative hypothesis. First of all, a linear model, when we have when we talk about single variable algebra, that sort of must make you think of a straight line. And indeed it is so. You remember from school, C plus MX equals Y, or you might have seen it as Y equals MX plus C, that C is the intercept such that when X is zero, Y is just going to equal C, and M is the slope, the rise over run. So with these values, two parameters, the C and the M, you can give me any X and I'll give you a Y. That's a straight line, as you can see there. So let's just visualize that. I've got the little equation here, Y equals minus 3 plus 2X. And I'm using the code here, first of all, using the arrange function from NumPy. I'm just going to have the values negative 1 to 5. And I'm going to go up in step size of 0.01. That's going to give me a bunch of X-axis values. Then I'm going to create a figure object. I'm just going to assign it to the variable fig. And it's a graph objects.figure object. That's what we create there. And then I could just add some traces to that fig.add underscore trace. And what I'm going to add is a scatter plot, also from the graph underscore objects module. My x-axis is going to be all the x values. My y is going to be minus 3 plus 2 times x vals. So each one of those, we're going to calculate a y value for. And that's going to create a nice little line for us. And let's have a look at what that looks like. And as we suspect, that's the straight line, this curve, minus 3 plus 2x. And it has an intercept when x is 0. Right there, we see that the x value is going to be, the y value would be negative 3. And then it has a slope, a rise over run. Now, when it comes to statistics, we use different notations. So instead of C plus mx equals y, we have these beta symbol. So beta sub 0, that's going to be the same as C in this instance, and beta sub 1, which is going to be the same as M, it's just the slope. And we multiply that by X, you see X is bold because it is a vector, the vector of all my independent variable values, and that's going to give me, if I do that sum, if I have these two values, the intercept and the slope, it'll give me this whole long vector of estimates for my dependent variables. So that's what we get. Now you see this little hat symbols there, because I just want to draw your attention here to equation number 4. We see beta sub 0 without the hat plus beta sub 1 x plus some epsilon equals y. So the x and the epsilon and y, those are all column vectors. That's just a list of independent values, a list of all of my error terms and the dependent variable value. So what we have here is what it would look like out there in the population as a whole. So in the population, we'll definitely know the value for beta sub 0 and beta sub 1. And so each individual will have an x value, an independent variable value. You see the x sub I plus their own specific error term, and that'll give them their real dependent variable value. But we don't know what that is. So if we write this out in words, by the way, it's the population intercept plus the population slope times the specific individual's independent variable value plus that specific individual's error value equals that specific individual's dependent variable value. That's out there in the population. Now we're estimating those because we only have a sample from the population. So in our instance, we put these little hat symbols on just to show us these are estimates of these two parameters in the population based on our sample. And if we have those two values, we are going to calculate an estimate of that, of the dependent variable value. So because we're only dealing with a sample, we're going to have a difference between what our sample's actual dependent variable value is and what our model suggests they are. And that difference, y minus y hat, gives us this error vector. So all the errors that we make in our model, and that is going to, we also call that the residual. So just want to show you what we build. So if we have this vector here of independent variables, 6876, that's our independent variable. And on the right-hand side, we have these estimates for what our model is going to calculate for dependent variables. So if we have beta sub 0 and we have beta sub 1, we multiply this beta sub 0 by a constant term. So they're all 1s, because if you understand linear, a little bit of linear algebra, you must know that we can't add these two vectors if they are not, don't have the same dimensions. So this is dimension 4, that's dimension 4. And so we've got to have this set of constants. So multiplying the scalar beta sub 0 times each of these elements will just mean beta sub 0, beta sub 0, beta sub 0, beta sub 0. And if we have a value for beta sub 1, that scalar times each of the elements in this vector, and that should give me then this. That's what we're trying to attempt. So how do we find these two values, beta sub 0 and beta sub 1, those estimates? Well, they're different techniques. There's ordinary least squares, or there's gradient descent. And that helps us calculate those two best values, because I'm going to get estimates and I want them to be as close as possible to the actual values. So let's generate some data, because this is all just words, words, words. Let's see what happens. Let's do this, see this in action. So I'm going to create some random values, and I'm going to create them in a specific way. Now, you can always import some data from a spreadsheet file or comma separated values file. But what I like to do is to generate my own data, because I have control over the generation of those random values, which means I can better understand my analysis. So let's try and attempt that. Now I'm going to seed the pseudo random number generator in Python here, such that if I run this code cell, I'm going to get the same pseudo random numbers. And if you ran this code cell, you would get exactly the same values. So I'm going to seed it with the integer 42. And then I'm going to create two arrays of values. And first one I'm going to assign to the computer variable independent, and the second one I'm assigning, remember the single equal sign means assign to what is on the right of this symbol to what is on the left. On the left is a very descriptive computer variable name, independent and dependent. So let's set up some independent variables. I'm first of all going to use the numpy.round function. It's going to take whatever the values are, and I'm going to round them, that's comma, to one decimal place. So what is these values? What are these values that I want? I take the statsmodel.norm.rvs. So that RVS function generates random values. And the norm refers to, I want those values to be taken from a normal distribution. I'm going to set a mean and a standard deviation. So I'm setting the LOC argument to 100. That's a mean of 100. The scale argument to 10, that's a standard deviation of 10, comma, the size is 20. So I want 20 random values from a normal distribution with a mean of 100 and a standard deviation of 10. And then all of those values, so I'm going to get 20 values from that normal distribution. I'm passing all those 20 values, which will be in a NumPy array. I'm passing that to the round function because I only want one decimal place. Now I'm just going to add some random noise to each of these. And that random noise is also going to come from the normal distribution. So I'm saying take all the independent variables, all 20 of them, and I'm going to add to each of them a very specific bit of random noise. And that random noise is also going to come from a normal distribution with a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 10. And you see I want 20 of those so that I can add element-wise 20 to 20. And I'm also just want to round that off to one single decimal place. And that's what we have. We now have values for an independent variable and a dependent variable, and all I'm going to do is I'm going to add those as columns to a data frame. So it looks very much like a spreadsheet file. So I have my values, which I'm now going to attach to a pandas data frame. So we see I have a computer variable df, and I'm using the data frame function from the pandas library, and I'm using a dictionary so that I have key value pairs. These two keys are going to be my column headers. And the values are just going to be those 20 random values that we just generated. Now, let me call the head method. So I'm going to say df.head, open close parentheses, so that you can see the first five rows. Now, remember, Python is zero indexed, so it starts counting at zero. So you see an index column on the left-hand side. So that's my first observation, had an independent variable value of 105, and a little bit of random noise that we added to that dependent variable is 119.7. Once again, I took control over how I developed these, and that will help me better understand what is going on. So they are the values. It looks pretty much like a spreadsheet. I'm only seeing the first five observations. Remember, I have 20 observations or sample size of 20. And for each one of those observations, I'll have a value for an independent variable and a dependent variable. So you can attach any two interval type or continuous numerical data types there to imagine what it would look like in the field that you work in. And this is what I'm trying to show again. There's my column of constants. So we're always going to have this column of constants, and that is a column vector. So, you know, behind all of this, or the easy way to do all these calculations, is with linear algebra. So in case you've never seen that, this is what we call a column vector, and I'm multiplying a scalar times a column vector. That means whatever this beta sub zero is, I'm multiplying it by one, by one, by one. So it'll be all the same values, plus beta sub one times each of my the values that I have here are all my independent variable values. You see them there, 105.0, 105.0, 98.6, 98.6. So each one of these will be multiplied by beta sub 1. And if I do that, so if I have beta sub 0 plus beta sub 1 times 105, I want to get as close as possible to 119.7. And you see that is my dependent variable, 119.7. For the second individual, second observation, second subject in my study, beta sub 0 times 1 plus beta sub 1 times 98.6 must get me as close as possible to 96.3. And as close as possible means I have got to get these values, beta sub 0 hat and beta sub 1 hat, those two parameters, they must take on values such that if I do this multiplication and addition on the left-hand side, I must get as close to as possible to those values. So we use these column vectors and scalar column vector multiplication. And let's express all of this as visually so you can see what I'm talking about. I'm using the express module here, the scatter function. I'm studying my data frame. On the x-axis, I want the independent column. On my y-axis, the dependent column. And the title is scatter plot of values for each of the 20 observations. And I'm also adding a trend line using ordinary least squares. So as I said, that's one of the techniques where we find these best values for beta sub 0 and beta sub 1. And it actually adds that trend line for me. And if I hover over that plot, it's very nice. It shows me the actual model. It shows me the intercept and the slope there. And it even gives me the coefficient of determination. We're going to look at all of those. So there's my model. So my model says for any input value, my independent variable value, I can plug that into my module, my straight line model, and it'll give me a value on this line. But you can well imagine there's a little bit of a difference between what the model is going to estimate or predict and what the actual value is. So there you see for each of my 20 observations, I see the actual dependent variable value given an independent variable value. So this plot really gives us a beautiful illustration of what linear regression is all about. We see our model, we see that for any given independent variable value, we're going to calculate a value that falls on the line, and there's going to be these differences. But that line is the best fit line, and that line has two parameters, only an intercept and a slope. And if I get the best values for that, and through a technique such as ordinary least squares or gradient descent, I will get the minimum, the smallest number of errors, or residuals as we'll call them, the differences between what the actual value is for that dependent variable and what the model is going to calculate or estimate for us. So let's see in Python how we set that up. It's extremely simple. We're going to use this OLS function from statsmodel. OLS stands for ordinary least squares. And we pass it a little formula there. And the formula has a tilde symbol in. On the left-hand side is my dependent variable value. And on the right-hand side, I can list with plus symbols all my independent variable values. And in this instance, I only have one. And these are the column names in my data frame because I say comma data equals df. And remember, df was the computer variable that holds our data frame object. So inside of single quotation marks, dependent, tilde symbol, independent. So dependent variable value given the independent variable value. And then I call the fit method on that. So dot fit, and that's going to fit the data to this model and work out for me using ordinary least squares the best values for beta sub 0 and beta sub 1. And from there, we're going to see a bunch of other results. So let's run this and see. By the way, I've assigned this to the computer variable linear underscore model. And now that I have this object that contains my model, I can call the summary method on that. So linear underscore model dot summary. And that gives us this beautiful summary table. And this is the table that we have to understand. We see a variety of things here. We see R squared up there, our coefficient of determination. We see an F statistic and a P value for that F statistic. And we see for given alpha value of 0.05, that's very significant, the value that we see there. We also see a bunch of other things, most notably this little table at the bottom. We see an intercept there, and we see an independent value there, a coefficients for each of those, standard errors for each of those two, a t-statistic for each of those, a p-value for a t-statistic, and then 95% confidence intervals around the statistic. So we've got to understand what all of these things mean. And it also, this table, I want to use the opportunity here to introduce again our null hypothesis and alternative hypothesis. What we're interested in is this independent that we see right here in the table. And we see it has a coefficient of 0.8. Now that is our beta sub 1 hat. And the intercept, the 12.76, that coefficient there, that's our beta sub 0 hat. And what we're interested in, of course, in our research question, remember we asked, and our null hypothesis was actually that this independent variable value is not a predictor of the dependent variable value. And we express that as this coefficient, beta sub 1. That's the one we're interested in. So our null hypothesis is that beta sub 1 equals 0. And our alternative hypothesis is that beta sub 1 is not equal to 0. And if I had more independent variables, other continuous numerical variables, that'll be a beta sub 2 and a beta sub 3. And our null hypothesis, we state that they are all equal to 0. And in this instance, we can see, given a standard error, we see a t-statistic of 3.5 that gives us a p-value of 0.02. So for a given alpha value of 0.05, this is less than that, we can reject that null hypothesis that this that the value that we see, 0.84, is equal to 0. We can reject that and accept the alternative hypothesis that it is not 0. In other words, in our instance, this independent variable is a significant predictor of our dependent variable. It really is as simple as that. So let's have a look at where these calculations come from. And the first of all, we're going to look at these coefficients. Remember, those are estimated parameters, or the estimates for these parameters, beta sub 0 hat, beta sub 1 hat. That is what the coefficients are, that COEF, right there in the table, that's coefficients. So let's see how that is done. Now I'm going to show you how to do it with linear algebra. And so you can just follow along. If you're not into linear algebra, you can't remember your linear algebra, just listen along. If you've had and you just need a little review, let me show you how it works. Now, first of all, to do this by hand, I've got to create these two design matrices. And the D matrices function is good in the PATSI package. And that's going to express two things for me. A column vector of Y values, that is my dependent variable values. And this matrix, where the first column is going to be all ones, that's my constant column, and the second column is going to be all the independent variable values. So I can just write the same little formula as we had before, comma, the data comes from the data frame, DF data frame. So if I run that, I have values, the vector, and I have a matrix. Now, to do this by hand or by Python code, I'm going to just convert these two to arrays. And so at the moment, they are D matrix objects from PATSI, but I'm just going to convert them to NumPy arrays. I'm going to call NumPy.array, and I'm going to pass y to that, and I'm going to again assign that to the same value y. So I'm just overwriting what is already in y, and I'm overwriting what's already in x. So I'm just converting these to NumPy arrays. And now that they are NumPy arrays, I can use some linear algebra. What I'm going to do here, let me just insert that. Let me just show you what these things look like now. So let's take y, and I'm going to use indexing. So I'm going to say, just give me the first 5. So up to value number 5. So let's see what this column vector looks like. And you can see there that's a column vector of all of my, or representing at least a column vector as a NumPy array, of all my dependent variable values, 119.7, 96.3. You'll remember them. Let's add another column, and let's have a look at this matrix X, so you can just see what that looks like. Let's just look at the first 5 values there as well. Let's run this cell, and there we see our column. It's a matrix, so it's got two columns there, and the rows, there'll be 20 rows because we've got 20 observations. My first column is going to be a column vector of all ones, and my second column is my column of independent variable values. You'll remember the 105 and the 98.6, etc. So this is what we're trying to do. We're setting up our problem as a linear algebra problem. We're saying, given this design matrix X times this column vector of my parameters, beta sub 0 and beta sub 1, that has got to equal this estimated values Y. And what we're trying to do here is a sum of squares. And the way that we're going to do that, what you can think of is the following. If just a little review of your linear algebra. If I have M observations, so M rows, M for the military mic, M. If I have M rows in this first column vector, of course, the second one's the same in my design matrix X here, that column vector lives in 20-dimensional space. Now, I only have two of these vectors, 111 and the other 105.98. So there's no way that I can span with those two column vectors. I cannot span 20-dimensional space. I'm going to span a subspace of 20-dimensional space. My vector of dependent variable values is not in the column space of the subspace that I'm spanning. So what I want to do, I want to create values beta sub 0 and beta sub 1 such that I'm as close as possible to this vector, that this dependent variable vector that is now not in my subspace. And it's that orthogonal projection onto the subspace that I'm spanning with these two columns that is going to give me the desired values. And the best way to do that, or the way to do that, is going to give me the best values beta sub 0 and beta sub 1. And so the way that we do this with linear algebra, I'm just going to multiply, left multiply by the transpose of my design matrix. I do that on the left and on the right hand side, left multiply, so it goes first. And if I take X transpose and X, now given that there's no linear dependence between these two, I'm going to find a nice square matrix of which I can take the inverse. So I'm left taking the inverse of X transpose X, that square matrix. And if I take a matrix and its inverse, multiply that with each other, I get the identity matrix, it disappears. And right there, I have an equation that'll give me that column vector of parameters. It's the inverse of X transpose X times X transpose times Y, and that is going to give me beta hat. And what we're going to do here is do that all in code here. So first of all, I'm going to get the transpose of my matrix X. So it's just X dot transpose. I multiply that by X itself. I take its inverse, and then I do the whole multiplication so that in the end, I'm just left with beta. And that is going to have two values. So let me just save them independently. There you see 12.76 and 0.84. And this linear model that we created with the OLS function, it has a couple of attributes. One of them is the params attribute. And that gives me the two parameters, beta sub 0 and beta sub 1. And look what we just had, 12.76, 12.76, 0.84, 0.84. Ordinary least squares using this technique that I've shown you in linear algebra that works. And that is how we find those parameters. It minimizes the sum of square errors. So that difference between my predicted value and my actual value, if I get that difference, I square all of them, sum over all of them, that is what I want to minimize. And that's exactly what we get here. So now I actually have these values, these estimated values. So if I take my research question, which was beta sub 0 plus beta sub 1 times my independent values, that is going to give me the values that I fit, this estimated values. And let's look at the first five of those. So that's going to be slight differences from what the actual dependent variable value was. Now, fortunately for us, there's in our model, there's also a fitted values. And then we say fitted values there. Attribute, and if I look at the first five of them, you'll see that's exactly the same as the fitted values we see here. So if we take beta sub 0 plus beta sub 1 times each of my independent variable values, I'm going to get this column vector of, and I'm just showing the first five of estimated values for my dependent variable, and that's also hidden, as I said, in the fitted values attribute of my model. Those values are exactly the same. The errors that we're talking about when we just generally refer to errors, those are also termed the residuals. And those, as I said, are the differences between what the actual dependent variable value is and what my value is in my model that I fitted. And if I subtract those two, I'm going to get the errors. There we go. So it's the actual values minus the fitted values. And once again, they are hidden in my model, linear underscore model dot resid. If I look at the first five there, we see that's exactly what we have there, the difference between the actual value and the fitted value. Now, what I'm going to do here, just to bring the point home, I'm going to create a new column in my data frame. I'm going to call it fitted value, and I'm going to add all those fitted values to it, which means I can show you the final result. And that's what just what we had before when we just added the trend line to our figure. So what I'm doing here is just creating a graph object's figure. I'm adding some traces to that. That's the independent and dependent. I'm doing that as markers and giving it a name, actual value. I'm now creating a model. So I'm creating a bunch of x-axis values, and that goes from the minimum of my independent to the maximum. And with a step size of 1, I pass my little formula to that and display that as a line. And then I'm also doing the fitted values. So you can have a look at that code, but this is what we have. So these blue markers are the actual values. And you can see for every actual value, there'll be a value here on my model line. And there's a difference between all of these. And we square all those differences, sum them, and we try to minimize that through ordinary least squares, which gives us this model that I've drawn here for you. And you can see all, of course, all my fitted values fall on this model because that's where it came from. And you'll see for each one, each of these pairs, you'll see these differences between the fitted values and the actual values. And now you know where these coefficients come from. You know exactly what they mean. And we've stated them in terms of a null hypothesis that beta sub 1 equals 0, an alternative that it is not. And in this case, we saw that we could reject that hypothesis. If we go just back just for 1 second here to the printout here on the screen of this model, remember what will happen if we look at independent here. There's our coefficient. There's an equation for the standard error for all of these models. There are specific equations for the standard error. And if I take my coefficient and I divide it by the standard error, I'm going to get a statistic. And this statistic in this instance follows a t-distribution. So given a degrees of freedom, we'll have different sampling distributions for that t-distribution. And for 3.587, that gives us a very small p-value, 0.002. And that value is then what we, with that p-value, if for an alpha value of 0.05, we can reject this null hypothesis that this value is not equal to 0. I'll accept the alternative hypothesis that it is not. So the null hypothesis that it is 0, the alternative hypothesis it's not 0, that is what we accept. And by the way, then we use that standard error and that critical t-value for our degrees of freedom parameter to calculate the confidence intervals, bounds for confidence interval, given a specific confidence level around that coefficient. So those are the coefficients. Now let's look at the rest of the table values that we do find. So we're going to look at these model statistics, and we're going to use the ANOVA underscore LM function from StatsModels. We pass our model as argument to that, and so let's look at these results. We see independent at the top, and we see residual at the bottom. We see degrees of freedom for each of those. We see sum underscore SQ, that's the sum of squared errors. We'll have a look at that. The mean squared error, an F statistic, and a probability for that F statistic. Now have a look at this. If I take my sum of squares and I divide it by the degrees of freedom, I get the mean. Sum of squares divided by 18, I get that mean sum. And if I take, you know, if I do that division of my mean squares, I'm going to get that F value. And from that F value, given these two parameters for degrees of freedom, I get a P value. So let's see how all of that fits together. So in a model, there are typically three errors. And if we go back to this little graph that we see here, we can discuss these three errors. The first error is the sum of squares due to the error or the residual. So that's these differences between what my model suggests the dependent variable is going to be, that estimate, and the actual value. So if I do that subtraction, some are going to be positive, some are negative. So I square all of those and I sum over all of these. That is my sum of squares due to the error. But there's also hidden here a sum of squares due to the regression. Now, unfortunately, that also starts with an R. So that R is sum of squares due to the regression, as opposed to the sum of squares due to the residual. We can rather use the term error so that we have an E there. So sum of squares due to the error, sum of squares due to the regression. Now, the sum of squares due to the regression is the difference between what my model suggests the dependent variable is, that estimate for any given independent variable value, and the mean of the dependent variable, because there is a baseline model here, a very simple model that suggests that irrespective of my independent variable value, I'm always going to predict the mean as this estimated dependent variable value. And it's that difference between what my model suggests and what the mean is of the dependent variable that is my sum of squares due to the regression. So if I do that little subtraction, square all of those, sum over all of those, I'm going to get the sum of squares due to the regression, the difference between what my model suggests and the mean for that dependent variable. So let's get back down to where we were. And that's what we have here, the SSE, the sum of squares due to the error. So I'm summing numpy.sum over the fitted value minus the actual value. And you can do that in either way order, because we're squaring over all of those. So the sum of squares due to the error is that difference between what the actual value is and what my model estimates. And if I square all of those, sum over all of those, I get the SSE. So let's run that. And I get a value there of 1,737.739. And look, that's exactly what is there. 1,737.7. So for the residual, which we mean we're using the word error here so that we don't get that confused with the regression. So the sum of squares due to the error is 1,737. And now you know what it is. I'm just summing over all those differences. So let's run that and save. That's done. And now we just have to think of the degrees of freedom, which we see here is 18. So the way that we can think about that is our total sample size, which was 20 individuals, minus, we can subtract 1 because we have 1 independent variable, and we lose another degree of freedom because we also have the intercept. So you can also think of that as 20 minus 2, which is just the number of parameters we have in our model. So 20 minus 2 is 18, so that's 18 degrees of freedom. When we look at the sum of squares due to the regression, remember, that's our fitted values minus the mean. So for each one of those, we're going to take the fitted value, what our model estimates, and the mean for the dependent variable, the very simple model. We square all of those differences, we sum all of them, and we get a sum of squares due to the regression, 1,242. If we go here and we look at this independent there, we see 1,242, the sum of squares due to the regression, that now involves this value that we estimated. And then we get this total sum of squares. That is going to be the actual minus the mean. So the actual value minus this very simple model, the mean model. And by the way, that's also just the sum of the sum of squares due to the regression and the sum of squares due to the error. So if we add those two, we get this total sum of squares, 2,979. Now that value helps us to calculate the coefficient of determination, R squared. But before we get there, let's look at how this F statistic was done. It is the ratio between the sum of squares due to the regression versus the sum of squares due to the error. It's always what we have there. And by the way, when we look at analysis of covariance, we're going to try and make that sum of squares due to the error smaller. And the smaller the denominator, the bigger the F value, the more likely I find a statistically significant F value there. So there we have the SSR, and we divide that by its degrees of freedom, and that will be the first degree of freedom of the two parameters that we require for an F distribution. And we take the sum of squares due to the error, and we divide that by its degrees of freedom. And I showed you how to do that. So if we do that here in this code cell and assign that to the computer variable F, we get that 12.867. And if we go back to our little table, there's the F, 12.867. So you see, it's just that ratio. And by the way, if we divide each of the numerator and denominator, which is the sum of squares for the regression and the error, by its degrees of freedom, you get the mean squares for each of those. And that's where we see there, the mean squares. So that's the sum of squares divided by the degrees of freedom. And there we get our F value now. And remember, for the F distribution, we require these two parameters, and I use this, the stats.f.cdf cumulative distribution function there, and I pass my F statistic value to it, my F ratio, 12.86, and then the 2 degrees of freedom, the one in the numerator and one in the denominator, which was 1,18. And remember, that'll give me on my distribution a little value, and it'll calculate the area under the curve up until that value, but the area under the whole curve is 1. So I've got to subtract that from 1. And if we run that code cell, we see that we get 0.0021. And that's exactly the p-value that we saw in our little ANOVA table. The last thing that I'll just add here, just for fun, is that coefficient of determination that we saw, and the equation for that is very simple. It's this ratio of the sum of squares due to the regression over the sum of squares total. And if we run that, we get our R squared value, which we saw before, and the way that we interpret that is to say that our model, in other words, our independent variable, explains 41.68% of the variance in the dependent variable. That's how we interpret R squared. So that's it for simple linear regression. I hope you have a good understanding of this. You saw the Python code and what those values mean. First of all, so easy to do in Python, isn't it? And then how do we interpret all of those results, and how do we express them in terms of our research question, in terms of these parameter estimates, in terms of, you know, a goodness of fit. So how well does this do as far as the R squared value is concerned, and this overall F statistic for our model. Now, we're just going to build on this when we talk about analysis of variance, because it is exactly the same as this. The only difference really is how we make that best fitted line, because now we're not going to have a continuous numerical variable as our independent variable. In analysis of variance, we have a categorical variable. But we're just going to build on exactly what we had here. Once you watch that video, it'll cement what you understand here, what you've understood here, and it'll just expand your knowledge into having other data types as far as our variables are concerned.